Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, or good day, wherever you are in the world, and welcome to the next episode of No Dice, No Glory. Sponsored by our jobs that actually pay us money, we're coming to you not at all live from an abandoned arms factory deep under a mountain in West Virginia. We are proud to proffer to you the finest in wargaming coverage. Without any further ado, let's get this show on the road. All right, thanks, me, for tuning us in today. We have a very special interview going on, but I have to for a moment just say I sound amazing, and I get to talk to myself right after I talk to myself, so that's pretty great, and I'm a little excited about it. But with us today, other than, of course, Mitch, and you've got Throck here as well, is Jon Russel, event coordinator for tournaments and conventions for Warlord Games. Yeah, we were really excited about this. Hey, how you doing, man?
And, you know, every time we've talked about Jon Russel on a podcast, we always refer to him as our new best friend, Jon Russel.
Our new best friend, Jon. You are an amazing interview, and we love talking to you about Warlord stuff. Had such a great time talking to you at Historicon, and we're glad to have you back.
And we'll be back there again.
Heck yeah. So how you doing, man?
Good, good. New Year's kicking off. We're starting to, the convention schedule starting to form up. Looking pretty hard, pretty fast. We're going to have a lot more than we did last year. We're shooting for 20 conventions. The Raiders are spreading out around the United States, so if we can't get there, we'll have a Raider there. We'll try to get you some kind of support. Either we're trying some new ideas with either sprues or discount codes on our web store. So we're using some different ideas on how to spread the word, spread the light to the uninitiated and help people out there get into Warlord Games.
Awesome. So let's start with, what are the Raiders?
The Raiders are the guys that are handpicked that I choose. It's one of those things where you don't ask to be a Raider. We ask you to be a Raider. So I got a lot of guys out there watching people in stores, watching people in sections and conventions, and we'll come up and say, hey, you know, you look pretty good, and we'd like to maybe use you as a Raider. So then what happens, he goes into the initiation program, and basically we watch him, and we have him do some demos, or we have him do some conventions with us, and then another Raider will recommend him. So it's the second vote, and then we watch them a little bit more. Then finally, the final determination comes to me. So it's a 3-level process to check you out. So when you see a guy that's got the Warlord Games shirt that's got his name on it and embroidered on it, and there's some kind of saying underneath it, like mine says Event Commander, then you know that the guy's been through about a year long and about 3 levels of being checked. So we want to make sure he's good. It's a little different than a Sarge. The Sarges are at a sanctioned store that has Warlord product and has a stock list or has a direct line to our people in Phoenix and the UK. They have a dedicated guy there in the store, and he's a Sarge. And what he does is he puts on events and helps the store take care of things. A Raider is more the guy that's out in the wilderness. We go to conventions, we go to unsanctioned stores to try to get him sanctioned, and we try to take care of the spreading the word and helping people out. And once that Pandora box was opened, holy mackerel, guys, we've been getting, for every one convention we go to, we get 3 or 4 more asks and about 5 or 6 tournaments. Right now, for a fact, Siege of Augusta is going on this weekend, so we got some surprise support going there. And then we've got, I'll send you guys the con list that we got so far. It always expands. We're going to go to LVO end of the month, then we go to Genghis Con, and then we got Twister Con in Texas, and then we've got Adepticon. And that's just the first 2 months.
Wow. So it seems like it's harder to get in Skull and Bones than to become a Russell's Raider.
Well, I want to make sure you guys know when you walk up to one of us that we know what we're talking about. We got a direct line to the guys in the UK, and you're going to get the help you need and support you want anywhere in the United States. And right now we're solid in the center, and we got some feelers out in the East Coast, but we're really hurting on the West Coast. So if you guys know of some guys out there that you've seen, you know are good, send me an email. We'll start checking them out and put my guys out there. We'll start doing some recce on them.
I think we could do that.
Good. That'd be great. Awesome.
Yeah, that's
I mean, those are high standards. I don't want to freak somebody out. Plus, I mean, it's like weird. You go up to a guy in the store, and I'm like, hey, dude, I've been checking you out. And normally a gamer might hit you at that point.
Exactly. But it's just one of those it's like the old Outriders from Games Workshop. You know, you had to have a certain level. You had to have a painted army or two. You had to have some knowledge, at least one of our systems. We've got about 6 or 7 systems now that we run. And we go from, you know, ancient Egypt all the way to the stars. So we've got some broad areas to cover, and we want to make sure that people get out there and play our games because they seem to be a lot of fun and everybody seems to like them.
Yeah, I got to sit down with one of your raiders. So one of my plans for 2018 is to somehow get into bolt action this year. Sure. I just picked up volume 2, and I was going to ask you sometime during the interview some good tips on starting an army, which maybe some folks are going to do what I do this year. Every year I try to pick up one new game that's been around, and I think bolt action is going to be my game this year. So it looks like you guys got a really busy 2018.
And for those of you who don't know, let's stick to the golden rule. And bolt action is a 28mm World War II platoon level game, miniatures game. Right. Yeah. I've loved it. I played it in version 1. I moved away from it, but now that 2's out, came out last fall, I think. I'm getting back into it. I've got Americans and Germans both, so Mitch, you and I, we're going to play some of that.
Yeah, I think so. I definitely think so.
Well, we cover everything, you know, from 1939. You can even go with our Chinese list, maybe even a 38 all the way to 45. And then if you want to keep on going, you roll into K-47. The miniatures are the same scale, and they work in K-47. Is World War II didn't end in 45. It's gone on. In fact, it's 1947. And there's some new stuff coming out for that, as well as bolt action. So we can get into that a little bit later.
Oh, yeah. And then, you know, I'd love to see Great War, but I don't want to push. I don't want to push.
You can keep asking.
Please,
there's some stuff out there.
Please.
So we've got some links. You're going to see a PDF file here pretty soon from our good friends Larry and Danielle Freeman. They've been doing a lot of work, and Richard's got it over there on our website, and we're going to release it here pretty soon. It's about 100 pages of World War One goodness.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Using bolt action 2 rules. Or is it a new thing?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, it's bolt action 2.
Maybe I'm going to wait. and are models going to be built too, or...
I don't know about that. We have the tanks, but we don't have a lot of the miniatures, and there's a lot of good miniatures out there. We're still kicking at it around. But in the meantime, in the interim, this supplement that Larry Freeman did is it'll wet your whistle.
It seems like it. Happen to know, do you have a timeline on that for us? Too early to tell.
I'll talk to Richard on Tuesday and find out when.
Awesome.
Let me write it down.
You heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. It's the first breaking news of the podcast. 28mm World War II level skirmish coming in the bolt action rule set in PDF form sometime this year.
For Great War.
Yeah. For World War One. What did I say? For World War
II.
Oh, I did. Yeah. For World War One, because I speak English. Yeah. Awesome.
That's right. So just like last year, Blood Red Skies, like I remember asking you, hey, this is coming out of nowhere. You guys are trying something new. What is something coming out new 2018 that nobody knows about that will freak us the hell out? Or should we say that for the end of the podcast?
Let's say that for the end of the podcast. There is something, and it's going to be pretty cool.
I'm already freaked out about the Great War. There's more. I'm so excited.
I am.
So let's just start at the top then. Let's start with bolt action K-47. And then kind of work our way backwards through your stuff. I guess really we could start all the way in the future with Gates of Antares, right? And then kind of work our way back in time, just to kind of keep a form to this. So Gates of Antares is your 28mm sci-fi platoon level, maybe a little bit larger, like Warhammer 40K sized game, right? You make all of your own models for it, and there are a number of factions out now. One of the big questions we had, Mitch, about it was you have the list, so I'll give it to you.
Well, we went to our FLGS, and hey, guys, if you see us and you know that we're going to be speaking to some of these guys, and we're going to probably speak to John as often as we can, come give us questions. So the two questions from Paul from Eagle and Empire in Alexandria, Virginia are, what's next for Antares? And how are the two new factions coming? Now, I don't play the game, so I don't know what they actually mean, but we are asking the question for him.
Oh, we just got done releasing a lot of our mercenaries in the Ruch. That's one of the bounty hunters, and we're working on that. We're also starting to fill in a lot of the stuff from the first book. You're going to see a lot of more transports, a lot of more vehicles. Well, we just released pictures of the Asorian model. It's beautiful. The Boromites just got out of their hauler. There's another one coming out. We just released Friday some pictures. Tim Bancroft released some pictures on Friday on our Facebook. The real big thing, if you're a Gates of Antares fan, is you got to go to the Nexus. The Nexus is our own website that has everything you'd ever want to know about Gates of Antares. Fantasy stories, pictures, ideas, painting tips, everything that Warlord Games has, www.nexus.com. That's it, the Nexus, I think. Or the link might be on our website. I think it's the Nexus. But NEXUS. And that's got... I think you're heading there now, probably.
I am heading there now as we speak. And I'll tell you what, make sure you email it to me. I'll put it in the article.
Sure, sure. It's I know the link's on our website, but it's phenomenal. There's about, we've been working on this really hard, and we've been trying to get it to release right. But everything that is anything, pictures, painting tips, tips on how to buy an army, how to paint an army, how to work with fast attack guys, what should I use these mutants for? Everything is there. It is all of the stuff for Gates of Antares. But in the meantime,
actually, the website, it's gatesofantares.com.
Yeah, it is www.gatesofantares.com, the Nexus.
There you go. Yeah. That's right, the Nexus. You'll spend hours on that site. It went live in November around Thanksgiving.
Yeah, I'm actually looking at it right now. And you guys have some gorgeous models for this. You said you have some new factions coming out. Is that right?
There's around later spring, early summer, we got a thing coming out called Drone Scourge. The Virari come back. The V-I-R-A-L, the Virari. They're coming out with their own supplement. It'll be our third supplement. And there's some really cool models coming out with that. We're hoping real soon. Watch the Nexus to see. But that's, and then there's a lot of Isaurians coming out, like single Isaurian guy standing, leaning, kneeling, stuff, so you can change up your armies. Right now we've got plastic Concord, we've got plastic Freeborn, we have plastic Algorin. We're working on getting some more plastics out. You know, there's plastic Gar, so we're working on maybe getting some plastic Isaurians or some plastic. The Algorins are out now, so we're working on getting more plastics.
Awesome.
Let me check my paper here.
And while you're looking really quick, one of the things I love about Warlord Games is it's kind of a one-stop shop for all sorts of wargaming stuff. And one of the things you have a ton of is terrain. Some of it you guys sell from other folks, some of it you make yourself. And now I'm pretty sure all the Antares stuff you make yourself. Is that right?
Yeah, Sarissa does that stuff, yeah.
Okay, are you looking at any new Antares terrain coming out in the new year?
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. There'll be some more stuff. Sarissa's always got some new stuff coming out. Sarissa does a lot of stuff for us, and Foreground does a lot of stuff for us. But Sarissa's got some great stuff coming. Yeah. And if you get a chance, check out some of the pictures from our birthday bash we had back in October. There's some beautiful tables that we played on for Gates of Antares.
Yeah, you guys have great models. I mean, I have some of your 28 mil Napoleonics. I mean, it just goes without saying, great models.
Why, thank you. I appreciate that, guys.
So should we go on to, so we covered A for Antares. We can go Bolt Action Black Powder.
Yeah, Conflikt 47 would be next backwards, right?
Yeah, let's do Conflikt 47.
And so the first question, the first question we have from Paul at Eagle and Empire in Alexandria, Virginia, was, will there be French in the new year?
French and Italians.
Not that I know of yet for French, but I do know the Italians are coming out next 6 months. They're going to be in our next supplement. We just released Defiance. Oops, did I just say the name of the new thing?
Do you want us to go back and bleep that out?
No, that's okay. We released Insurgents, which was the Japanese and Finns. And right now, the next one's going to be Defiance, and that's going to come out in the next 5-6 months, and that's going to have Italians. And the neat thing about that is it's going to have both factions of the Italians, the Axis Italians, different models. The Allies, Italians, different models. And they're kind of cool looking. And it's going to bring, our intent is, I believe, is with this supplement will be bolt action 2. So K-47 will be bolt action 2. So it'll be same rules.
Oh, which is good.
I know you've been working to bring them in line, like Resurgence kind of pulled it over a little bit. I was flipping through the book today. And so with the new one coming out, you're going to be completely in line with bolt action 2. That's awesome.
There's going to be, of course, models. I don't know if you guys seen the pictures of the Japanese use animated corpses like the Germans, but their animated corpses, they don't care who it is. So if you look at the Japanese animated corpses, you're going to see Japanese, Australians, British, and American animated corpses in their animated corpses line. And then we're going to have the British are animating their vehicles or Brens. So you see pictures of the robots inside Brens. So it'd be like animated remote control things. Super snipers.
I really love that.
The Germans are going to come out with some the super medic, who will use, and he's better at getting your guys back up on the field, but the parts might not match, if that makes sense. So he doesn't care how he fixes you. And then, of course, the British are going to come out with their animated corpse killers, the dogs, and those dogs are beautiful, the hunting dogs. But you got to be careful where you release them, as you saw in Resurgence, because when they start attacking, they'll attack anybody.
Yeah. And one of the cool things about Konflikt 47, for those of you who live under a rock and haven't seen it, is it takes World War II and puts it into Weird War II, essentially, right? It morphs World War II into this 1947 era. The war keeps going, and everybody's now using kind of Weird War tech with walkers and jump troops and risen zombies, and the Finns have werewolves, and it's all sorts of crazy fun stuff that adds a little element of high-techy fantasy to the game.
Not zombies. We don't have zombies in K-47.
Oh, no zombies. What are they called again?
No zombies.
Animated corpses.
Animated corpses. No zombies.
Zombies is trademarked, I would assume.
Somewhere around there, yeah.
So, hey, do you find a lot of your bolt action, even with the rules being very similar, soon to be the same, do you find a lot of your bolt action players play K-47? Or we're talking two different types of animals here?
No, and what's really great about let's talk about a box of American plastics, okay? Might or may not be being redone. We'll see. The plastics, you get a box of plastics, you get 30 guys for like $40. All right, you put them together however you want, and now you've got a squad for early war, late war Americans. Those same guys with a tank, you swap the tank turret, and now you've got a K-47. And I'm working on one more use for that box of Americans. Pretty soon you're going to start seeing some stuff or some grumblings, or you're going to start hearing some stuff about another conflict that happened about 5 years after World War II. Same Americans.
Let me guess my history.
We're going to get Korea.
We're going to get Korea.
We're going to get Korea. That's amazing.
Yeah, I'm working on Korea stuff right now, and what's great is that same box of guys, those Americans, with maybe a 3.5-inch bazooka instead of the little 2.75, maybe some Persian, or maybe some Pattons, will work for Korea. So now you buy one box of miniatures, $40, 30 guys, you can use them for bolt action, K-47, or Korea.
So triple. While I am sitting here blown away with my crestfallen expression, so Korea, that's new, never heard of it before. Not a lot of game companies touch Korea. I am
28 mil.
I am ecstatic that you guys are doing Korea. Why the move into Korea? It natural progression or?
It's one of my kind of favorite things. My dad was there. It's so easy to convert over because it's at the end of World War II. All the stuff is the same. The only thing is we have to figure out how to really use jet aircraft, how to use bombers, and how to use the night fighting is going to be bigger, and some of the higher tech, so some of the newer weapons. T-34s were there, T-34-85s were there.
Yeah.
You know, sermons, everything was there for 3 quick years. And my thought process, and we're working on it, my thought process, you know, we're going to introduce, it's either going to be a PDF or it'll be a booklet format like our campaign books. We're still kicking that around. And I got to go, in fact, I'm going over in February, back over to the UK to do some more discussion about this. But there was 24 allied, NATO, and about 6 or 7 communist factions. And I want to try to get at least one scenario for the majority. So we're going to have at least 15 or 20 scenarios, a lot like our last one we just did, the Battle for Berlin. There's like 20 plus scenarios in there. So what we're trying to do is do something like that. So one book, boom, bolt action, V2, and you can play Korea.
Oh, my God.
We already got 3 scenarios done. We're working on some more.
I'm incredibly excited.
Is this 2018 or 2019? Because you really want to get the first Korean War out before we have to fight the second, maybe the next year.
Yeah, exactly. I'm hoping as fast as I can write it and play test it. So we're working on it. We've got 3 in that bag. We want to get at least 10, 15 more.
You know, wow. If you need playtesters for a Korean War or a Great War book for that matter, we know some people. You might be looking at them.
No Dice, No Glory has a lot of people.
Good.
Not saying, because ladies and gentlemen, your second bombshell of the night is Korea for bolt action.
Yeah. Watch your side.
Huge. Yeah.
Wow. That's going to be awesome. Like, all right, I don't even want to go there because we can go down a rabbit hole. And by that, he needs to write it. So wow. So that second bombshell.
Let's just end here and go let him write it. Like, we can just stop. Go take the rest of this interview to go write that.
It's great. We even got guys from Australia helping us do some testing. So it's really great. So it's really becoming, I'm really having fun with it.
So you know how you guys make those like semi-historical, really from TV and film, special characters? You got to put Hawkeye and everybody in for MASH.
You got to have MASH in
there. Oh, sure. You got MASH in it? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
You got to have MASH in there. I would love a Corporal Klinger model. And I'm just saying.
And we're also, the rumors are that there's some kind of dozen coming too, but who knows? We'll see.
What?
Oh.
What?
Like eggs?
Are they unwashed?
They might be unwashed. Yeah, we'll see. We're still working on that idea too.
Now, I heard that rumor somewhere, but I don't know if I heard it via mouth or. Anyway, I'm going to get in trouble if I keep elaborating on this one.
And here's something that's going to work for whenever we do Korea, and it's a new sprue we're coming out with, and this is really cool. I saw it at the birthday bash. We're really excited about it. It's going to come out probably end of this month. Everybody wants it. It be used anywhere you want to use it. It can be used on any time period. It's a sprue of animals, plastic sprue of animals.
Okay. Cool.
Cows, horses, chickens, ducks, stuff like that. But the real kick in the pants, guess what the code is for this sprue?
Z-O-O.
No.
F-R-M.
E-I-E-I-O.
That's amazing.
Just like, oh, wow. I love the puns. The punniest company ever.
Yeah. So
I don't know.
I
don't know, man. I'm already excited about Korea. I'd hate to ask him another question, but I'm gonna let him go. I'm gonna let you go.
Okay. We'll do that for another podcast.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah,
all right. Please. So where are we now? Are we
bolt action? We're into bolt action for real, and you wanted to ask a lot of questions about bolt action.
So you saw the releases. We're gonna start doing some Market Garden. Market Garden's the next one. So we're ramping up. A lot of stuff's coming out for that. A lot of new plastics. A lot of new miniatures. It's a fantastic book. It's got a lot of good stuff in it. It's another thick book, another campaign book. Beautiful illustrations. You know, we got the Osprey stuff in there. The figure. If you order it direct from the web store, you get the Urquhart's figure, the guy with the L horn. You know.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And it's got a lot of good stuff in there. The Polish are in there. The British are in there. There's a lot of scenarios. You're gonna love this one. And then
Polish para or Polish first armored, maybe.
Well, that would be for later. In the Polish Paras, if you look at our, what's really great about that, the British plastic paratrooper sprue, if you look in the top right and top left, there's 10 heads
with
berets, right? Five of them have Polish berets, five of them have British berets, and they're the real deal. So, I mean, if you want to do Polish, there you go.
Awesome.
So that's coming out. And then we're having another, I think we're releasing another Pegasus Bridge. I think another second edition is coming out for that. We're starting to come out with some of our own D6. You've seen some of those and some of the teasers we had. We've got, with the market garden, we have to do some new airborne stuff for the U.S.
Nice.
So there'll be some new stuff coming out for that. Maybe guys with looted weapons, maybe, you know, stuff like that.
Maybe second with Panzerfausts, that would be great.
Guys in hand carts, you know, and maybe we'll have a guy looking like some Duke dude or something, you know, getting pulled around. I don't know.
Yes,
so,
please.
But so watch for that. It's gonna be there's gonna be a special miniature. He's called Never Surrender. There's a campaign book coming out. Some stuff that the British used in that action. And then let's see, looking ahead later on, we're filling in some more stuff like guys in great coats for some other armies. And then maybe later on, we might do another campaign book, with the release of maybe some new plastics, of a certain type for a particular event that happened in June sometime.
Oh, interesting. Operation Migration. Yeah. Oh, you mean in the West, I think.
But on the coast.
Oh, oh, not the Russians. I got you. All right. Yeah.
America's Bruce,
Mitch, you don't have rhymes a protection army.
Rhymes with Bormandy?
Yes.
Well, you see, and here's the thing. I don't. And a lot of it is Bolt Action 1 came out. I was involved in doing other 15mm games. I've gotten the rules. You know, I'm waiting for, you know, I guess Sean's hand-me-downs or the sleepover at Jon Russel's house. But, yeah, I mean, one of the things, too, that's interesting about the Bolt Action website is, and even the game is, okay, 1,000-point standard game, and I love how you can build. I love the boxes that come out. Like the box we looked at today for, I think it was 145 retail.
It's the army.
Yeah, and it's a full-up German army, and that's awesome because other companies don't do that, where they say, bam, you want to do this? Here's your 1,000 points. And, you know, I'm caught between taking Polish Paras or play British. I really wanted to play something new in that, and I still may look around, but that's what I kind of like about it. Like, I know the boxes I want, and just to learn how to play the game – to me, it's, you know, the more I move into 28 mil with all these different games, the more I enjoy it. So I'm like, as a new player for me, will the Market Garden book scratch a lot of itches from what I want to collect?
Oh, yeah. Well, and what's great about the beauty of the Bolt Action system is, you know, you buy the basic box set for $112 or $110, and you get two squads of American Airborne, one squad of Germans, some terrain and a half track and the rule book and all the bells and whistles you need. And then you can either get that starter the army that you talked about, you know, the army box set for 145, or we've got that option called build an army for 120. And you can build and pick and choose the components of your army. Like, I want this box of this infantry and this box of this infantry, and I want that tank, and you can build it for 120. So, you know, 120, 145, boom, you're done. You got your 1,000 points.
Yeah, and it's right on it's warlordgames.com, and you just go to Great Britain or Germany, build an army. I mean, you have two really good options there, and I kind of like that. So besides getting the models, and really I should look to get a 1,000-point army, I need the book, and I need the markers, I need the dice, and I could be ready to play. Well, I have to paint first for like $150, $160.
They're British. They're brown and tan. You're fine. Don't worry about
yeah.
it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and those army books, Bolt Action has been out for about 8 years now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we've changed one rule book and one army book. And that's all we've changed in 8 years. So we're kind of proud of that. No right. codex creep.
Yeah. Which is kind of nice.
But, and it's good. We're having a lot of fun with it. And we look forward to doing some more stuff. You know, we had a great release with the New Guinea campaign with the Australians. That just came out in November. That was a fantastic. And it's got a lot of great new miniatures with that. And we're still working on that one. So a lot of good stuff coming out for that.
Awesome.
Yeah. So that's what
I'm personally very excited. Yeah, absolutely. Bolt Action, it was a game I liked a lot back in the day, and you know, you kind of cycle through games, but if Mitch is getting into 28mm, I'm going to be playing some 28mm, I can tell you.
Yeah, and I'm going to write articles as I pick it up about my trials and tribulations with that. So,
that'd be great.
Hey, I'll be the test, so if you see me and you really want to win a game of Bolt Action, ask me to play a game, because I am relatively... very new. Well, I mean, if it was any game, I'd probably lose it. So that's exciting for Bolt Action.
Now let's go to the sky. From World War II, let's go to the skies, blood red skies.
I was about to say, let's see some blood red skies.
So your tease last year for blood red skies, we actually went to Gen Con to go play it. I liked it. The guy didn't really have a ton of time to show us, but I noticed that you came out with the $50 kit that has 6 German, 6 British, and everything you need to play the game. And I've been dying for years to see a good air game. Tell me about Blood Red Skies of 2018.
Blood Red Skies are going to be released in March. All the stuff's coming out. We've got Germans, we've got Russians, we've got British, we've got Japanese, we've got Americans. And you're going to have a basic faction to start out with of about 6 aircraft with those, and you have the rules. And what's great about Blood Red Skies is it removes that what altitude you're at and what are you doing and how fast you're going kind of thing. Basically, it boils it down to 3 things: disadvantaged, neutral, advantaged, and you're done. And so you can look at the model, because they're on a unique swivel base that slots forward, back, or stands straight up. And you can look at the aircraft, you know he's either advantaged, disadvantaged, or he's neutral. You don't have to ask what altitude you're at. It's quick, fast. Game's usually done in 45 minutes. A lot of stuff's coming out for it. We're releasing everything in March. There's even some aces for each one of those factions. We had a lot of trouble picking them, but we've picked a couple of them. There's a Japanese ace, a German ace, a British ace, a Russian ace, and a German ace. And each of those cards have a little special ability. So there's some cards involved in the game if you want to make it up one more level, notch it up one more. So you can play straight up basic, not have to play the cards, or you can start using, depending upon what front you fought on, the aircraft did different things, or doctrine was a little different. So there's doctrine cards, there's nationality cards, there's cards that affect certain aircraft. Some aircraft were just crap. Other aircraft were phenomenal. So there's cards in there to help us. So it depends really about how much you want to peel this onion, how deep do you want to go. Again, even adding those cards and stuff, the game plays real fast. It's a lot of fun. It's typical Warlord games, not a you go, I go. It depends upon what the aces are doing. And then they start off, you know, there's 5, 4, 3, 2. That's the levels of experience in this game. So everybody in 5, all the 5 advantage would go, then the 5 neutrals would go, then the 5 disadvantage would go, then the 4 advantage goes. So you work your way down to the guys that are meat, basically.
Yeah.
Go loud.
And one of the things I love about this game, oh, go ahead, I'm sorry.
That's a quick synopsis. It's a little fast, you don't need any terrain, because, well, we do have some terrain. There's some clouds and some balloons and stuff like that. So they'll cause some stuff, and you run into a cloud, you can change your level by 1. It's quick and easy. If you position yourself right, you can get 2 shots off in a turn. And if you're an ace, you get a couple more. But the thing about it is you got to think about it. It's almost a beer and pretzel game, a lot like our Test of Honor, or Test of Honor, like you call a sushi and sake game. But we'll get into it later. But it's you have to think, but it's a lot of fun. And there's going to be more supplements. I don't know if you guys watch the Facebook page, but the guys in the shop picked up a Hornet 1/200 scale. That's what this is. So they're building a 1/200 scale Hornet. And then you're going to see some stuff here pretty soon on our website about the attack on the Hornet.
That's so true. We might see some Wildcats or some Avengers or maybe some
Because in May, I'm self-aggrandizing plug, Warlord Games Con is coming up May 18th, 19th, and 20th. And at that event, Warlord Games Con, 18th, 19th, 20th of May, we're going to have four tables that are going to interlink. One table is going to have the Red Skies. It's all Pacific. It's all Guadalcanal. Because one table is going to be the Japanese bombers coming in trying to hit Henderson Field.
Nice.
One table will be bolt action, large scale, trying to, you know, defend. We're going to kick it down to we're working on some skirmish rules where instead of one squad gets a dice for activation in the bag, all the guys in the squad get activation in the bag. So that's a smaller level, really, really a skirmish. It'll be one or two, one platoon, maybe two, checking out a Japanese village. And the fourth table is, oh, wait, we said we'd say that to the end of the interview. So the fourth table is something we're going to come up with that comes out later on this year that's going to also include something that we can use at Guadalcanal.
So we got air, we got ground. This will be UFOs?
Yeah, UFOs make sense. No. Yeah, I like that. Yep, yep.
I like it. And the folks out there that are interested, Blood Red Skies is not out yet. As John said, it's coming out in March, but the basic rules are free to download on warlordgames.com. I've downloaded it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One of the things I love about the game, having played it once, but the graphical design of the game, the cards and like the art style of it, and I'm a big nerd for stuff like that. I like something that looks good and plays good, right?
Yes, he is.
We've had endless conversations about this, actually. But yeah, it's gorgeous, right? Like, the card art is gorgeous. The rules look amazing. It's just a really well-produced game.
And it's got the line art of the 40s in it. All that stuff. There's a Coca-Cola ad. It's all line art stuff from the 40s. It's got that 40s feel. And it's pretty good. And, you know, Andy Chambers wrote the rules, and he's no slouch, you know.
No slouch.
Yeah, he was at the birthday bash, and I get a chance to talk with him. There's some bombers coming out. You know, there's a whole bunch of fun stuff. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to have a lot of fun with that game.
I'm looking forward. Yeah. I'm very excited about that one. Wow.
So let's back it up a little bit more. To Black Powder, right? That's next in...
Sure. We just released our... That was Clash of Eagles. That was the Napoleonics related. A lot of stuff's coming out with that. We're releasing a bunch of French models. A lot of stuff for the Peninsular Campaign. It's a beautiful book. It's one of the best books we've written for that period. There's a lot of more armies coming out for that. A side shot of Black Powder is also our Piking Shot. And you guys saw, we just announced in January, late December, early January, we're having a Pike and Shot Samurai Armies. The Pike and Shot Army list is on our website. If you Google it on there, or you search on our website, but we're going to have a starter army and armies for Pike and Shot Samurai, which kind of ties into our Test of Honor.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's awesome.
And we
go ahead.
So we just released the Test of Honor, you know, the attack on the dojo. We finally got Andy to say yes, and the ninjas came out. They were always there with students.
Yeah,
attacking one by one.
Yeah. And what's kind of neat about it, and now this is a rumor, I haven't been able to find out yet, but I think this is true. Sarissa released a set for the Brigands and box set that has the little lanterns in it that you can build up. Well, they also have measuring sticks that are katanas, and they're 9 inches long, and they're divided so you can use a katana for your measuring stick. I'm told in the dojo form, the dojo attack, there's a similar sprue or cutout of MDF for those same four lanterns, but the measuring stick in that one is a Wakasashi, which is a straight, not a curve. That's the only place you'll be able to get that measuring stick. So I haven't seen it yet. I haven't got a chance to get my hand on one. But there's a possibility that you can get just the Wakasashi, and you can only get it through that one. And, of course, the mounteds are coming, and there's a bunch of more releases for that. You know, the Test of Honor is going so great. We've sold it out twice. We're on our third run. It's going phenomenal. It kind of fits into the Black Powder. It kind of doesn't. It's a little different. The Black Powder stuff, we get off on a tangent there. But the Black Powder stuff, we've got, like I said,
I have a question about one of your releases for Black Powder. So the band, the head of the guard head, is that for play or is that more for show?
They might be able to march faster. I just saw the pictures of them today or yesterday, and it could be for show, but I do know that they got a lot of stuff. That's anytime you have a parade, that's out front first. So there might be more French figures coming out, like Imperial Guard, regiments, sappers, drum corps. You know, they're going to lead the way for more miniatures to come out.
Yeah, it looks pretty neat. I mean, I'm definitely going to pick up the sappers, Imperial Guard sappers, just because they look sharp.
Yeah, yeah. So there's going to be I'm trying to look ahead some more.
While you're taking a look, let me ask you another question.
Sure.
I love the pageantry of 28mm gaming, especially when it comes to Napoleonics. I have found the amount of models one needs to put on a really epic sort of 28mm game to be a little daunting. Do you have any advice for a new collector of 28mm Napoleonics on how to get a good start on just building a solid core of that army?
Remind me to pay you later for that question, because you led right into what's great about that idea is go to our website and check out the Waterloo box set, okay? The Waterloo box set. It's $140, $150, and there's like 175 miniatures in there. Plus the rule book, okay?
Wowza.
Yeah, it's an 85 rule book. Right? So you get terrain.
Yeah.
Check out the Waterloo box set. There's a metal commander for the British and a metal commander for the French. But you get all the miniatures you're ever going to need to play Napoleonic Black Powder in that box.
Right, because Black Powder is really two or three regiments fighting each other, right? You're not looking at a division's worth of stuff. You're looking at maybe a single division fighting a single division of three or four regiments and cannons.
Yeah, if I can remember that box, I think you get like two infantry, an artillery, and a cavalry for both sides.
Well, I have it right here. Yeah, you get 48 infantry each side, 24 Hanoverin, British commander, French commander, one artillery piece, 12 chasseurs, a cheval, a softback version of the rules, and an easy start guide. So, I mean, this is kind of awesome for $112, because I know
$112.
I know that I collected and I bought a lot of your box sets. I spent way more than this, and I probably spent way too much. This is awesome.
Yep. And then we've got, you know, because we're doing that Clash of Eagles, we're going to have more British and more Napoleonic artillery. We're going to have some Landstreich coming out. We're going to have, that's Pike and Shotte, sorry. But we're going to have a bunch more stuff along that vein for the French and British.
And awesome. And I'll put out, too, about your models. There's a lot of people that I don't want to play 28 mil, especially Napoleonic, because I'm not a good painter. Well, probably of the three of us, I am the worst painter. But the French with the gray coats.
Confirmed.
Yeah, the French. Well, they don't look bad. The French with the gray coats, they're easy to paint. You know, I find your models extremely easy to paint. The models also look great. Don't be scared because it's 28 mil, because I was worried about that. And then a lot of people that are really good painters go, 28 mil is easier, man. And I'm like, well, I don't know about that. But it's don't be scared. And because all you're doing is you're missing out. and play in a great range with some of these great games that are made for that scale.
Yep. I think I have to make a correction. I think the Clash of Eagles is the Russian campaign.
It should be the Russian, yeah.
Yeah. Not the British and French, not the Peninsula. That's the Russian and that's the French. And there's a lot of Russian stuff coming out with cavalry and stuff. The Napoleonic one is that they're starting to come out with more of that stuff for it's Napoleonics. So it's British and French. But yeah, a lot of stuff for the Clash of the Eagles is Russian, and I apologize if you guys are gonna get a bunch of he said Russian and it's not Russian. Okay, I'm sorry, it's Russian. It's the Russians and the British. Russians and the French. Yeah. Sorry.
All good. You got a lot of products you're dealing with, man. That's huge.
So for all the periods Black Powder covers, are Napoleonics the most popular?
Yeah, I think Black Powder and the spinoff Pike and Shotte with all that English Civil War stuff. But then the beauty about Black Powder is you start going down all these rabbit holes, Zulus, American War for Independence, what we call the Revolutionary War. And then
I hate you for this, by the way. And I'll explain why. Because I'm only learning one game system, and I'm interested in Napoleonic period as just reading wise. But, I'm also interested in American Civil War. And I'm also interested in American War of Independence. And damn it, is Zulu not one of my favorite movies. But here, I don't have to learn new rules. So you make it very easy for me. And I'm just thinking that you guys are taking advantage of addicts like myself and Sean with these games. And I noticed the Black Powder period's like that. And I've mentioned on podcasts before, why don't I just go get an army for AWI or Zulus? Yeah. I hate you for that, but I appreciate it.
Well, yeah. Glory Hallelujah is ours. And then we've got Blood of the Nile. That's our the British Colonial Wars. It seems like every time you turn around, there's another one coming out for Black Powder. So it's phenomenal, and I love it, and it's a great game. And it's a lot of – I like it because it's just quick and simple and easy.
Yeah.
And you read the rules, and there's some funny stuff.
Rule set. Yeah.
Yeah, you should have named the Rourke's Drift book, Sometimes You Win, Sometimes You Lose.
That's John Starr's favorite period. He, in fact, took one of his vacations. He went there, and he walked along all Rourke's Drift and San Luana. And if you go to his house, there's a Zulu shield in the corner. It's pretty cool.
Oh, that's wow. Really cool. Yeah, I'm actually really interested in the Crimean War because it's so, at least here in North America, it's not something you ever see, right? You don't – it's not like in England where, Crimea – people do the Crimean stuff, Battle Sevastopol, and they do the English Civil War. And that's the other one. I'm actually a big nerd for Pike and Shotte Swedes, weirdly. It's one of my, most random one of my most random historical instances is that, Swedes versus Poles in the 1600s. It's just fascinating. And you can go all the way from Louis XIV all the way up to Kitchener in the Pike and Shotte and Black Powder rules. And it's just, it's an amazing rule set, and I'm really glad we have it from you guys.
Pike and Shotte. Oh, and the writer of that was Steve Morgan, and he might be a guest at Warlord Games Con, 18th, 19th, and 20th of May, Oklahoma City.
Oh, and where do I sign up for that? Because I've heard it mentioned before.
WarlordGamesCon.com. WarlordGamesCon.com.
Yeah. And I'm just going to ask the question. The Pike and Shotte rules and Black Powder are very similar, I believe.
Yes. So, they're just a tweak for use of the pike and some different formations but they're pretty close.
Yep.
So for anybody that really has an addiction to gaming for at least 400 years, one rule system takes care of you all, and of course some of us hate you for that.
Yeah, and speaking of a long period of time. Oh, go ahead.
To Kill the King was our last supplement for Pike and Shotte, and another I have people come up to me of that period and they say Pike and Shotte, Kill a King, Black Powder, Clash of Eagles were some of the best supplements ever seen. So, hey. Awesome. Oh, yeah. I also say that I don't know if you guys saw War Games Illustrated said that the best 28 mil rule set was Bolt Action and best new game Test of Honor.
Nice.
So, oh, and best for service, Warlord Games. But you know, hey, I'm yeah.
You're a high quality multiple millennia gaming service, and we love you for it.
It's okay to be biased.
It is. You work there for you them. Go. You literally pay to be biased, and that's why we love you.
Because at least, you know, you're right 50% of the time. No, I'm just kidding. No, I mean, it's kind of awesome. And I have the Black Powder rules never played. I have Bolt Action rules never played. But it's written by the same design team. So as we move forward, or, you know, like if you're a gamer, you may never get off warlordgames.com. You just may spend your entire wargaming career there. Wow. That's, I don't know. I'm excited.
Yeah, Rick Priestley and Jervis Johnson did a great job on Black Powder with John Stollard and everybody. And then Steve Morgan did the Pike and Shot. So, yeah. And then Rick Priestley wrote our Gates of Antares. So, there you go.
Right. So, from Gates of Antares to the future to the par past, right? Let's take a look at Hail Caesar.
Oh, Hail Caesar is another phenomenal, fun game. If you remember the old War Master kind of idea, that's kind of how it's written a little bit, because it's written by Rick Priestley. We've got a bunch of stuff coming out for that. We just kind of did a tease this week and last week about the Roman invasion of Britain. The box set coming out here pretty soon.
Oh, nice.
And then, of course, there's a Spartan army coming out and a Greek army coming out. So we've got all that going on. And then we've got a bunch of fill-ins, Achaeans, Nubians, Libyans, a bunch of that stuff coming. There's all kinds of Ottomans coming. So we're really starting to fill in the Hail Caesar stuff. Wow. And then of course a spin-off of that from Andy Hobday and some of his friends that did Test of Honor is Gangs of Rome. And I'm sure you've seen that stuff. And that's another kind of fun little game that's now releasing this month. It's kind of crazy. And if you watch Gangs of Rome here pretty soon, all of a sudden you start seeing Romans in the streets, and then pretty soon you're gonna see Roman legionnaires in the streets, and then you can just lead that right into your Hail Caesar games.
I'm glad you brought up Gangs of Rome because I wanted to ask about it. Rome is, ever since I was in high school, I took Latin for 4 years. Rome is one of my favorite historical periods. The television show Rome is probably one of the best television shows HBO ever did. One of the seasons focused on the Gangs of Rome. And so I've been kind of interested in it ever since. How does that game set up? Like, what does that look like? What can you tell us about it?
It's a lot like Test of Honor. You have a gang that one of your principal guys, you can get the rules downloaded right now, just like the Blood Red Skies PDF file. And you build your gang, male and female, because there is no, everybody's involved in it. And there's some cool little rules. It moves a lot like Test of Honor. You're trying to promote your benefactor and get him into the Senate, or try to get his point across on the street to some folks. There's some really cool rules on it. Depending upon how many times you get hit, there's little blood chits you can put on the base of the miniature is designed that you can snap in these numbers. So A, you can identify the guy. So there'll be like a green 3, green 4, green 5, green 6 will correspond to your miniature. So you have a card that represents your guy, a lot like Test of Honor. And then there's also a counter to show how many times he's been hit, and it slowly gets more and more bloodier. And these guys can run around and do different things. Depending upon which god they follow, they have different specialties. And the moves the same way as Test of Honor does. Guys, bags and chips, pull them out. And then if you run it, what's kind of cool is one, there's mobs that are walking around because there's mobs in the streets, you know. Mm. And when your gang members getting chased or trying to hide, can run into that mob and then hide, and then, sorry about that, that was my phone. The gang can hide in there, and then he can teleport to another mob somewhere, so he can actually move across the board through the mobs.
Oh, wow.
So it's kind of cool.
That's really cool. So
it's a cool system. It's a cool miniatures. Footsore's doing a lot of the miniatures for us. And it's you take a denarius, and you can buy certain little abilities for your guy. And it's a fun little it's not quite beer and pretzel, but you know you'll enjoy it. It's a lot of fun.
Hello.
Hey, go ahead.
Hey, so you've been talking Tester Von a lot, and I tell you, I've spoken to some people about that game, and once again, not my period, but people will have told me, if you like great games, play Tester Von, even though it's not your period. And we talk about beer and pretzels, but Test of Honor, I know we talked about it last year, how's that doing? Is that a great game that you guys are going to expand in 2018?
It's a sake and sushimi kind of game, not a beer and pretzel. But we've already sold out two runs. We're on our third run. We can't keep it on the shelves. There's a lot more stuff coming out. Yeah, you've seen we had the latest release was the Attack on the Dojo. There's going to be several more like that this year. There's a bunch of stuff that we plan on coming out with. Female monks, female samurai, more mounted troops, different things that are coming out with that. So there's different time periods. It's really a successful, lot of fun. And it's just, what I like about it is you can say, hey, look, I've only got 25 minutes. Let's play a game of Test of Honor. Let's do 5 points. Or you say, look, we got an hour and a half. Let's play 24 points. Or, so you can adjust to how much time you have to play to how big a game you want to play. So
rules are free, too.
You can download the rules. 5 points gives you about 3 or 4 guys. 20 points gives you 8 or 9 guys. Everything's in the box. $50, 35 miniatures, come on. Right. Come on. Right?
Yeah.
And it's neat in there. So it's quick, fast, and simple. They are a little fiddly. I'll give you that. Some of the stuff for the samurai, put the little stuff on their helmets and stuff. It's a little fiddly for old guys like me. But they go together well. They're a lot of fun, and you can customize that thing as any way you want.
Hmm. Wow. I don't know. Yeah. It was either between Bolt Action or Test of Honor to get into. And I got to be honest, why I made that decision for Bolt Action is availability. I know some of the Test of Honor stuff's tough to get. It sells out.
Awesome. Yep.
That's awesome.
Great.
Yep.
So I know we're not on end spoilers yet.
No, we haven't even talked about Doctor Who yet either.
Yeah.
So there's friends of ours, and this is for Christina.
Sure.
She loves Doctor Who. And she would kill me if I didn't ask about Doctor Who. So I will tell her to listen at this point. Tell Christina about Doctor Who and why she should get her son, and her family to play that game.
Doctor Who is a game that involves all aspects of the game. It starts off in the box set with just Daleks and Cybermen. But what they're doing is they're fighting for the Time Vortex. And they're trying to control, like they always do, the whole universe. But what's really cool about Doctor Who is it's expandable. There's 3 rule books in there, which you can download the PDF. And one book is the game. One book is scenarios. And then one book is adventures. And your doctor and his companions can go on adventures. Now, the scenarios have certain setups. But every time, if you want to include the doctor, there's a little caveat in the corner or somewhere on the piece of paper that says the doctor's in. And when the doctor's in, they changed the rules for that scenario a little bit. And right now we've got the 11th, the 10th and 12th doctor, but we've got other doctors finalized and they're in the chute to come out. So we're going to have pretty soon, eventually, all the doctors, all their companions, and all the monsters for Doctor Who will be out and available.
Nice. Wow. That's really exciting.
The models themselves are true 28s. And the process that we do, it's crazy. We work with BBC. And our sculptors will do the model, give it to BBC. BBC gives it to the actor. The actor says yay or nay, gives it back to the BBC, and then gives it back to us, and we cast. Sometimes that's a long process. Sometimes it's a fast process. But it's an actual true blessed by the character model. And a lot of people say, well, why do you put on the bottom of the base the 12th Doctor or Rose Tyler? Yeah, we all know who they are, but it's still cool to put their name on the miniature just so you can figure out who they are.
Just let me know if I can ever meet, Amy Pond or or what is her name? Jillian, I forgot, or David Tennant, or, you know, Peter Capaldi. Those are some of my favorite actors. And if you ever have a chance to, you know, have them somewhere, have me there too.
You know, the Doctor Who magazine just came out. I think the special edition just came out, and there's a huge article in there about when I was over there for the birthday bash. Those guys were there doing interviews. There's a bunch of pictures of some stuff coming out, and there's a bunch of interviews with the guys and how they did and other things. So if you're a Whovian, check that latest edition out. The special edition come out, and there's a big article in there about Warlord Games and the board game.
Awesome. Do you find games like Doctor Who pull in people that are huge fans of the show, but they're not necessarily gamers? Because it seems to me that all the Doctor Who games seem to do that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And it's just, when you do something right for 25, 35, 45 years, people start buying in, you know? And Doctor Who's been around since 1963, okay? 54 years. So they've been doing something right. What's that? Yeah.
Predates me.
Yeah, so it's one of those things that there's a true love, and you have to be careful about that to make sure you do it right. And I think we really hit this one out of the park. The miniatures are beautiful. The game system, if you've played our Project Z game, it's a lot like that. And it's just so much fun. There are some quirks. There's some cards you can play. Some of the pictures in the cards are straight out of the TV series. You know, I'm your doctor. I'll be your adversary for this evening is a card. There's some funny stuff in there. Spoilers is a card. There's just so much love and care went into that game. They even have a guy that just does nothing but Doctor Who stuff at the staff there in the UK. And Alan, I think his name is. And he did a great job. They've done a great job. And Doctor Who is a true love. Along with, you know, some of those other British things like 82,000.
So, wow. Speaking of which, we've come to the end of the game line, and you were gonna tell us about some spoilers.
I mean, if you want to delay it more, I have some. We can make our folks wait out there for a little bit. So that's the thing that sucks. I can always fast forward. So, should we go to the spoilers?
We can go to the spoilers.
I'm very excited.
I don't know about you. I'm putting on a seatbelt. Sean, I recommend a seatbelt. We actually have Maddie, who is one of our other podcasters from the Canadian contingent. He's on as well.
Oh, yes.
He's been listening in. So, Matt, if you can, say hi. But are you buckled in? I'm ready for these spoilers.
Here we go. Sometime in the near future, we're going to start covering an aspect of World War II that we haven't covered before. Now, I kind of alluded to it a little bit before. But we've covered air. We've covered land.
But you haven't covered tunnels. So I think it's probably going to be tunneling, right? Is that what we're going to do? We're gonna, yeah.
And I have some tunnel questions I like to ask, but yeah.
In the New Guinea book with the raids and stuff. So there's actually some stuff in there.
Without any further ado, something's going to happen in the Navy.
So we're working on looking at a small action 300 scale kind of boat game.
300 scale.
Yeah. So that means nothing bigger probably than a cruiser or a destroyer. So we're talking 300 about
scale is pretty big.
Yeah, so we're talking about MBTs, PT boats, stuff like that, submarines, you know, stuff, the small boat actions, like Guadalcanal running assault boats down the slot to get more Japanese troops to Guadalcanal.
Huh. Wow.
Is there
going
to be an air component to this, perhaps?
Well, that'd be Blood Red Skies.
Okay.
And the two games will be able to be played simultaneously for one scenario or
something like that. Or we're still working on the linkage, but right now we want to get the game out itself. And there's a bunch of cool little caveats. And it's written in the same style with some tongue-in-cheek stuff in there and some funny little gaffes. And It's well done. It's well written. It's a lot of fun, and we're working on that. And it, we're looking for next 6 to 8 months release. You might see it at Warlord Games Con, but just something that we wanted to do for a while. We finally got a chance to do it.
Wow!
And so this is this is amazing. We're talking to start with. It's going to be Japanese and Americans in and around Guadalcanal, Iron Bottom Sound, and the slot, and all that good stuff. Destroyers and smaller, essentially.
Yeah, why pick that scale? Curious, because like I do World War II with 1/6000. I mean, am I going to need a huge table for this scale, or is it going to be much like Blood Red Skies, where I could get a really good game in like a 5x6 table or 4x6?
4x6, 4x4, like Test of Honor. We wanted more emphasis on the small boats, you know, like St. Nazaire Raid. You know, they had a bunch of MBTs rolling in there. Dropping off a spy on the coast of England or France. The S boats and the K boats coming up and down the channel. The PT boat actions trying to chase down the assault boats in the slot or somewhere in the Pacific, trying to knock out a seaplane base. So there's a lot of small action kind of stuff like that, that scale fits pretty good. So you can get a good, it'd be hard if you did a 1/600 to do a PT boat. It'd be just a little piece of metal.
Yep.
The 300 scale, it's a couple inches, you know. And then, you know, the yachts and the sampans, and it moves fast like Blood Red Skies. It's got some really cool little actions, and some of these bristled with weapons, so they can shoot everywhere all over the place. A lot of night actions, so there's a lot of night rules, star shell, stuff like that. So far, it's pretty exciting.
We'd like to volunteer two playtesters at any time.
Yeah. And sure. It's fascinating because this is a part of the naval conflict that is rarely covered in historical wargaming.
It just isn't.
Yeah. And so to me, and I mean, this is John F. Kennedy. This is some of the crazier stuff that happened around Guadalcanal and even later when you were with all the rest of the stuff in the New Guinea Sea. I'm really excited to check this out because there's so much little drama. Go ahead.
Yeah, can you get off Corregidor? You know,
right.
You know, that's how we got out of it. Right. So make a scenario for that one. So it's just there's a lot of potential that hasn't been really looked at, but there's a lot of fun there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I. You know. Once again, you guys are hitting a niche that to me is perfect, like Korea. But if you look at like the naval campaign in the Pacific, you got your midways, you got your coral seas, but read a book about the Navy in Iron Bottom Sound. What's that? What's that book that you and I both read, Sean? That was amazing about the actions off of Guadalcanal.
Yeah. I'd have to look it up again. I can't. I'm losing it, but yeah, the actions.
Yeah.
Any of the books about Guadalcanal tell you about how the small, like the little pocket stories or whatever, were trying to make their way into the Japanese side to drop off infantry and supplies.
Yeah.
They would try and float it in, but the PT boats were always trying to intercept them. And there's, I mean, that's great gaming, right? Like that is a great sort of scenario game.
And I do the 1/6000 naval in the Pacific, and I've shown Sean the ships. I can fit my 200 ships in a T-10. And people are like, well, how come you don't play with the carriers? And how come you're not doing like Surigaro Strait? I'm like, the die was already cast back then. But you look at that whole Solomon's campaign, it is fun. It's even. It's balanced. It's great. It's gameable. I think that's going to be for people. And, you know, I noticed a lot of guys that have little dudes on figures don't do something in the ocean. I think that this may be something folks should try.
Yes.
Just like.
Yeah. Well,
go ahead, sir.
I said, you're going to enjoy it. It's a lot of fun.
Wow. So you've played it or you've heard about it?
Yeah. Well, you can tell us and then you have to kill us. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, you know, we'll hit stop on the record. So. Wow, that's exciting. So let's see what we got here that's exciting. We got Korea. You see, but in a way, you screwed me up because I may stop collecting my bolt action to wait for Korea.
Stop it.
I don't know if I should do that.
Still get your Americans for bolt action. They'll still work. They can play Game
47. He doesn't play Americans. He's weird.
I don't play Americans. Yeah, because I am one. I am one. There's no fun. And Finns probably won't work in Korea. I just have a feeling. So we got that. Japanese. So we got that coming. We got the naval game coming. So it looks like the Great War, which you know I'm really thrilled about. So, you know, once again, for some of us, you've made some tough choices. Damn you, sir. Damn you, sir. We might have to show up at
Warlord GamesCon.
Warlord GamesCon. Go ahead. In Oklahoma City.
May.
18th, 19th, 20th.
WarlordGamesCon.com.
Okay. And there's still plenty of places to sell up. Sign up for that.
Sure.
And of course.
Oh, yeah. The first 25 get a special little swag bag thing that in the past, the first 25 got something special. There's 100 swag bags. Everybody gets a sprue. But the first 25 get something special. Like the second year we did it, everybody got a tank sprue. Full up tank sprue. The third year, everybody got Gates of Antares drone, one of the big drone sprues. Last year, everybody, those first 25, got a Dalek and Cyberman sprue. So, something a little special.
Awesome.
So, if I sign up, I would have to show up to pick that up, right?
You'd hope
yes,
so.
Yes, you'd have to go, you big poo.
I'm looking at the thing now. It's at Will Rogers Road, which I assume is near the airport. And it's called Boxcars to Versailles. Does that have anything to do with it being 2018?
Yes, it's the 100th year anniversary of the end of World War II. And in fact, there's a special miniature that'll be in that bag. I'm glad you said that. Last year's special miniature was Blackjack Pershing, done by Footstore, Bill. And we also had a Doughboy done by Patrick Keith from Counterblast. He did this. So I had two special miniatures. This year, Bill Thornhill said, okay, John, what do you want in the special bag next year? I said, well, Bill, people tell you what to do. How about you tell us what you want to do? So the special miniature this year in our bag, everybody will get 100 of them, is a Tommy and a Fritz with just in their uniform, no kit, and they're reaching out to shake each other's hands, and it's called 11th Hour. And
nice.
We're going to have one painted up by Dave Taylor. He's going to paint one up for us so you can see what it looks like. But start looking forward to seeing some of the pictures of that. But it's a Tommy and a German shaking hands over the no man's land, and it's called 11th Hour. So it's an homage to the 100th anniversary of the end of World War I.
And we will put a link on the article that goes with this podcast, so you can check out both Warlord Games and this. And there's an interesting picture of Mr. Russel wearing a Northern English Scottish skirt.
Every Saturday. That's what I wear.
You got to let us pull it off, my man. It's a kilt. We know. Wow, I'm excited about a lot. What about you, Sean?
Dude, I am excited about the Great War. I'm excited about Korean War. I'm excited about the Gangs of Rome. I am excited. I love talking to you, John, man. You are a one-man cheering leader squad for Warlord Games and always get me so revved up about it.
So one of the things I look at you guys at Warlord Games, and maybe you can or cannot answer this, is you look for these niche areas, and essentially I could do any conflict from ancients to the future with you guys. You have rules that are interrelated, so there's not a learning curve. Is this something that you guys, well, when the company started, is this something, hey, we're going to do? We're going to put in systems that interlock and be really a game that, as a gamer, you don't have to learn so much. It's more you could focus on collecting and building armies and really feel the different tactics of the periods with my run-on question.
No. I would love to say why. Yes, we thought the whole thing out when we first started, and it was perfectly set up and everything. But to be honest with you, what happened 10 years ago was John Stollard and Paul Sawyer were sitting around John Stollard's table in his kitchen and said, hey, you know, we both don't have jobs. We've been made redundant from Games Workshop. What do you want to do? And they said, you know, I'd like to make the best historical miniatures historical in the world. So let's try that. So we've been doing it now for 10 years. We've been trying to find a way to make it better. We want to be proud of the miniatures we do. We're very proud of the miniatures that we have out there. We have over 5,000 products now. In 10 years, we've got over 5,000 products that span, like you said, from ancient Egypt all the way up to the stars. And we're still going. We're only 10 years. I think we've been very lucky with the people, with Paul and John, who started this, thought out and have done this for each of them in Games Workshop, you know, for over 20 years. They know how this is done. We have those connections. And we try to make sure that we want to make them fun and playable and beautiful miniatures. And so far, I think we've hit it out of the park. So even though as much as I'd like to say, yes, we planned it from the beginning, no, we didn't. But we've been having some great designers that we're able to make sure that that's that, the outcome of what we've done.
Okay, I'm gonna have follow on that one too. So we talked 2017 offline after we turned off the recording about, you know, we mentioned, I think in the podcast, this is the golden age of gaming. 6-7 months later, does 2018 look to continue on that growth, or are we getting close to where we may be hitting critical mass?
No, we've got some new games coming out, some new lines coming out. Some stuff that we haven't talked about. We're also not allowed. What's that?
We're not allowed to talk about, I guess, right?
Well, we do some stuff for 2000 AD.
Okay.
2000 AD, really?
Yeah.
You didn't know about that.
And we did Judge Dredd.
I'm a huge, like, I'm a Judge Dredd nerd ever since I was, I don't know, a kid reading Judge Dredd comic books, and I played the Judge Dredd miniatures game, the Judge Dredd card game when it came out. I love Judge Dredd. I didn't know you did anything with it.
Yeah, well, we did for a while. We were helping Mongoose sell their stuff. Now that's run its course, but we like AD 2000. So
yeah,
there might be something in the future from AD 2000 coming out. That's all I can say about that.
I always thought I was like this obscure gamer who didn't like things other people liked, and then you're like, no, we've got Great War in Korea and Judge Dredd, FYI. What? Okay, well, I'm over the moon with you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, so and we're helping out some other guys. You know, we also, John and Paul like to help the little guy. You know, like we helped out the guys over Lucid Eye and doing their Savage Core stuff. So we helped them sell that for a while. We're helping Gangs of Rome sell. If one person benefits, everybody benefits. So why not help everybody get a leg up? Why not help everybody get distributed? Because we all like to play games. We all like to get sit around the table, move miniatures around in kibbutz and drink alcohol beverages or normal beverages or have a little fun wherever you want. And it's stuff like that that builds friends, builds lasting relationships. I don't know if I talked to you about this, but I have a 19-year-old daughter that kind of games. She likes Space Wolves, bless her heart. But she also likes to push miniatures around. And when we were over 2 years ago, we were over in England visiting the guys over there. We got a chance to go play at John's house. And we played a Black Powder game. I was playing 95 rifles. I was playing the British. And I was coming up the side. And here comes my daughter with a bunch of sachets, a bunch of mounted French guys. So I tried to form up in a square. And she formed up. And she just kicked the shit out of me. And I just killed me. I looked at her and I said, you got to realize something, baby. It ain't going to get ever better than this because you're in John Stollard's house playing Black Powder. You're kicking your dad's ass. You're having a ball. You're having a little bit of gin and tonic because that's what they do over there. And
drinking ages 18.
Yeah. And John's got a bunch of really cool paraphernalia around the wall, you know, inactive weapons. It's Zulu shield. And he's a great host. And I said, that's a memory she's going to carry with her. That's what this is all about. You know, and just to wrap it up and close this thing out here, because I know we're getting busy, but that's what gaming's about. And if we can find a game system, we call it fishing in other ponds. If we can find another niche like Test of Honor or Doctor Who, and it's feasible for us, we're going to do it. And we're going to do it. The Warlord, it's going to be the best thing you've seen, and we're going to get the best guys on it, and you're going to love it. That's what's great about Warlord Games.
Yeah. So we asked you a question last time. What do you play besides games that you know you worked on? Is there any new games you picked up since then? Or it could be any type, board, card games, but Anything that you picked up that you would recommend?
Savage Core is great. I love Savage Core from Lewis and I. I really, that's the old Journey to the Center of the Earth stuff. Fabulous stuff, fabulous miniatures. I've been playing some, I go back and I'll play Fallout, or I'll go out and play, Dead Island. I like that a little bit. I've been playing Bolt Action, Test of Honor, Blood Risk, guys. Something besides, I'm sorry, you asked me something besides Warlord.
I guess if there's no answer, there's no answer, you know.
There is no answer. Sorry. Wow.
That's all good, man. That's some product love right there.
Yeah. Well, look, I don't know about you, Sean, but I think we should have him back every couple of months.
Every couple of weeks.
Sure.
Yeah.
Every couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've been bothering him since we decided to start No Dice, No Glory. I'm going to keep bugging him for, you know, for us to do some reviews, some spoilers, whatever you guys need. Hey, we're here. But sure. I'm excited. I'm real excited, man.
Yeah, I'll get you guys a list of all the college conventions we'll be at this year, so maybe we can link up a couple times.
Definitely.
That would be awesome. That would be totally awesome. And maybe we'll take a ride out to Oklahoma City.
About 18th, 19th, and 20th of May would be fantastic.
Wait, what was the date again? Was it the 18th, 19th, and 20th of May in Oklahoma City, WarlordGamesConvention.com?
Between Mother's Day and Memorial Day. There's no way in hell I'd ever mention a Mother's Day.
Right. Well, thank you so much again. We have today with us was Jon Russel. He was the event coordinator for tournaments and conventions for Warlord Games. It's been an absolute pleasure, Jon. Thanks again for talking to us.
You betcha.
Thanks so much for joining the show tonight. Remember to follow us on Twitter at No Dice, No Glory, and keep the conversation going on NoDiceNoGlory.com, now featuring our own message boards. Have a great night, everybody.